Good morning, everyone. I'm Vidhi Thakrar.
I'm Nazneen.
We both are application developers at ThoughtWorks. So in this session, we are going to discuss about a test pyramid of any normal Android application. What are the problems with that test pyramid? And together, we will achieve the pragmatic test pyramid by applying some design principles. We have created a very small basic shopping application as an example on which we are going to work together to achieve the pragmatic test pyramid. If any of you don't know what is test pyramid, then it will be covered in next few slides. Now, Nazneen will explain the functionality of this application.
Hello? Hello?
Yeah, it keeps going.
Hello? Okay, so we have created a shopping application, Gadget Stop, where you can purchase some electronics and accessories. So when you launch the application, you can see the concise information about some products, like the image, the title of the product, the price, and as you can see, some label, new, popular. So the business requirement about this label is, if a product is new, the label new will come up. If the product is popular, the label popular will come up. And if the product is new and popular, the popular label gets precedence and the popular label will come up. So as you can see, there are no products in my cart right now. Let's go and add some. I click on one of the product. I can scroll down to see the description. Okay, it looks pretty interesting to me. Let me buy it. I add the item to the cart. If I try to add the item again to the cart, I get a dialog saying this item is already added to the cart. Again, a business requirement. Now, if I go back, you can see one product is added to my cart. So that's the functionality we are going to be working with today for the achieving the ideal test pyramid. There is no function, we have not implemented the functionality for cart. Okay, so let's do a quick code walkthrough for this particular application. So the very first activity we launch is the shopping activity. In its on create, we set up the action bar. We create the fragments and set up the view pager. Let me go into create fragments. So there is an electronics fragment and an accessories fragment. Now each of these fragments inherits from a product based fragment. Let me go into that. So the product based fragment, basically on its on create callback, we fetch some products from the server. So there's an API call. We make this API call using an API client, a wrapper over the HTTP client. We take in the URL. Okay, do I need to fetch electronics or do I need to fetch accessories? And I pass a callback. This callback basically, if I get all my products from the server, I render these products. And if it's an error, I show a dialog that there's some difficulty and close the activity. Let's go to render products. On render products, it's a simple setting up an adapter. It's a base adapter which helps you set the products on the view. We clicked on one of the products. We chose one of the products, and when we clicked on it, we open up the product details activity. Now, when I go to the product detail activity, on its own create, I render the title. I render the description, I render the cost, image, and the label, either it's popular or new. I do all this on its own create. Well, this is about the rendering part. There's one small functionality left. When I click on the buy button, I add to cart. So, either if the product is already in the cart, I get a message, okay, this product is already in the cart, or if this product is not in the cart, if you're adding it for the very first time, you get a message, item is successfully added to the cart. So this is the functionality we are going to be working with today. So before we go jump into, okay, what are the various test scenarios and what should be the testing strategies for this product, for this application, I'll ask Vidhi to just explain the importance of tests.
How many of you have written a test for any system? Oh, nice. What do you think? Why you should write a test? Anyone? No one? Sorry? Yeah, correct. Let me go through quickly the importance of test, that why we should write test. It proves that your code actually works. Whenever you we develop a new feature for our system, right, we develop it incrementally. So whatever you have developed, it actually works, test proves that. It improves design. So without thinking of the responsibility of the class and the collaboration between multiple classes, you cannot write test. So it always helps you to design your application correct. It allows refactoring. Just think about a situation that you want to refactor a piece of code and there are no tests around it. It's scary, right? You might miss some scenarios to cover in your refactoring. But if you have tests around that code, then refactoring becomes a painless, because by just running the test, you make sure that you have not broken anything. Good documentation. If you have written a test, you don't need any sort of documentation, because tests describe the functionality and behavior of your system. It forces you to slow down and think. This is my favorite point. So whenever you write test, you first have to think about a class on which you are going to test something. And you also have to think about the expectations from that class in terms of assertions. And then only you can jump to the code. It reduces fear and boosts confidence. So sometimes tests help to catch a very critical situation or a critical scenario of your system. I'll give you an example. For example, there is a legal link in your application, right? Somehow it has been broken. And without testing the application, you have deployed an application. Just think about it. Your company might have to pay a lot because of such violation. If you write test around it, then you can avoid being in such a situation. It makes deployments faster. If you have written enough number of tests for your system, then just by clicking a test, you can make sure that your system is working as expected, and you don't have to spend so much time in manual testing and regression testing, and you are ready for the deployment. Is this clear to everyone? Yeah. Now Nazneen will discuss the test scenarios of the application which we have created.
So now that you've got an idea that, okay, we feel it's important to write tests, for this particular application that we saw, Gadget Stop, what are the tests that you think, you know, you should write? Anyone? Sorry? Write tests for the labels, in the sense new and popular is coming up. Okay. Okay. One. Any other? Sorry. No duplicate items, right? Okay. So this all you're going to assert on the dialogue or the message, or what are you planning to test around here for both for the scenario you just stated? So are you going to be testing something? Okay, a dialogue appeared and this is the message, or what were you thinking when you said that? Okay, anyway, any other scenario? One last? Oh, sorry, to check there is no error. Okay, yeah. Okay. Let's proceed with this. So, some of the scenarios that you listed, and some of us, we had a few scenarios. Now, most of the scenarios 6 months ago, Vidhi and I, with the team we were working, 6 months ago, if we were thinking of the scenarios, most of the scenarios needed something of the UI to be there. Like, we would think, okay, is the new or popular label being rendered on the screen? Is the price being rendered on the screen? That is what is going to be seen to the user, right? So you'll think, okay, we need to test it's getting rendered or not. So most of the scenarios we end up with needed the UI for the So we ended up with an inverted test pyramid where we had a lot of tests in the functional side, in the sense which needed the UI, and a very few unit tests. Now by unit tests, we just checked, okay, the logic in the model. Okay, if you know the label is new, popular, something that way, we tested in the unit. But most of the tests were on the UI side, pertaining to see that, okay, the view is rendering fine. And this is the inverted test pyramid. Now to understand why is this called an inverted test pyramid, or why this is not the great way to go, let's quickly see what should be the ideal test pyramid. Okay? So your ideal test pyramid, or the pragmatic test pyramid, or this testing strategy you can apply for your application, should involve three main components: unit, integration, and functional. By unit, I mean you take one particular individual component and unit test it. These components are tested in isolation. It has a disadvantage, of course. These components are unit tested in isolation. You do not know that, okay, a unit A works in collaboration with unit B perfectly fine. And there is when integration tests come into picture. So your integration tests give you the confidence that, okay, my 2-3 units are working together. You don't need a functional there, and that's where integration tests shine. Functional in that way helps you, as the name suggests, gives you confidence that your user flow, what your real user will use, is actually being tested, is actually working fine. So to just summarize it, integration and unit, being technology facing, they help us understand, are we building the system right? Just going back to the point Vidhi said, are you designing the system right? Are you designing it in a way that it's maintainable, etc.? Functional on the other end puts across, are you building the right system? Are you building the system that your clients want or what the users want? So as we move from unit to functional, the confidence that you're building the right system increases, because you have more coverage on the unit, integration, and functional, of course, because you're testing that your system, you're building the right system. But at the other hand, once you move from unit to functional, the speed of your tests decreases. The amount of data or the amount of time your functional tests run compared to your unit and integration is much more. So let me put this all, let me summarize them and put the characteristics of these tests again. So just to summarize, unit tests are fast. What I mean by fast is your test refactor cycle is faster. You write a code, you test it, it fails, you understand, okay, what is broken, you fix it, make some changes, again run your test, and you come to something is wrong, right, okay, perfect. So it's very quick in feedback. Your feedback is, okay, something is broken, fix it. At the other hand, functional, you have to build your complete product, then run the complete suite on it, and then you come to know, oh, I've broken something. It's too late in the cycle to get some feedback that you've broken something. Unit tests, they don't have a lot of dependencies. First of all, you mock most of the dependencies, and they do not have UI in the picture. So it's much more reliable. Whereas functional, you deal with UI and take into consideration, you have a scroll view. You may not know that why has your test failed. Has your scroll view genuinely started lagging behind, or you know your app Genymotion or the emulator is slow and therefore started lagging. So you never know why your test has failed. It's not really reliable at some time. Unit test, as you're testing just one single unit, it fails, you come to know, oh, this has broken. My price is not getting appended with the Indian currency. That's where it's broken. But when you run the same thing with functional, it can be anywhere, that failure. It can be that even if your test find a bug, that bug can be anywhere in the product. So it does not help you isolate the failure immediately. It takes you time to understand where exactly something must have been broken. And of course, unit don't help you simulate the real user flow, but functional does. So we realized, okay, we understood these problems, we understand the disadvantages of having so many functional tests, but still we ended up with such an inverted test pyramid, as I showed before. We analyzed and figured out, okay, why do we have less unit tests? What's the problem? We could not write unit tests because there was no capability of dependency injection. What I mean is, when you're creating, so first of all, in your view, so Android framework gives you activities, fragments, is where you write all your view logic. Everything to render, talk to the database, talk to the network, everything is where you, is your starting point. Now, as you're creating them in the activity, if you can't inject them, how will you test it? And the reason you can't inject them, because you can't create them on your own. You can't create an activity, you can't create a fragment in the test. It's only through callbacks or through intents. So if you can't create them, you can't inject things, and therefore you can't test it. First problem. I mean, the first thing that caused a hindrance in writing unit tests. Okay, you all may say, come on, there was Roboelectric, why don't you utilize that? There are Roboelectric tests, that is for unit testing, why don't you write that? Now, there are two issues that we faced. First, Roboelectric tests, to test non-UI logic, you need to set up a lot of data. Prior to 2.2 version of Roboelectric, you had to create shadows of activities, of fragments, etc. To test non-UI logic. Why do I do all this setup when I don't want to test something on the UI? But I had to put an entry point, so set up all that data and test it. Second, if you're testing get text, set text, etc., you are actually testing them on JVM. Okay, JVM, it runs fast, it gives me quick feedback. But your actual application runs on a DVM. So you're running it against an altogether different ecosystem. Now, we didn't really like that, and so we ended up writing no unit test, JVM unit, no JUnit unit test, no Roboelectric unit test. So we had hardly any unit test. So as a team, we have come across some, we came up with some patterns which will help us increase the unit test. Vidhi will take us through that.
Okay, so as we understood that there are disadvantages of writing so many functional tests, let's see what can we do for an application which we have developed so that we can write unit tests easily. Let's go to the product detail activity. Here we have written some rendering logic. Let me go to the render product popularity. Here we have quite some logic. You can see over here. What we are doing here is, okay, if the product is new, then the label should appear as new and the color of that text should be red. If the product is popular, then label should appear as popular and the color should be purple. If there is no product coming, if there is no popularity coming in the product, then we don't have to display altogether this text view. And if it is coming, then only we want to make it visible. So we have quite some logic here. Can we do something so that we can easily write unit tests for this? Yeah? Have you guys heard about MVVM? How many of you have heard about MVVM? No one? Okay. How many of you know MVC? Quite a few. I don't have to explain the MVC, right? We can directly move to the MVVM. Is that fine? Yeah? Okay. Alright. So here the responsibilities and view and model stays the same. Let me just quickly repeat it. What is model? Anyone? Sorry? Yeah. So that is like your data, right? It represents your data which can be retrieved based on the user interaction and it is displayed on the UI. What is view? UI, right, which presents to user. It's your graphical user interface. Okay. Now, what is view model here? So let me just give you a brief idea about MVVM, and then we'll talk about the view model component. So MVVM was developed by Microsoft architects to simplify the event-driven programming of user interface. Cool. So what it does is, it separates the development of user interface from the development of the business logic which you write. Yeah. Now let's talk about what is view model here. So the responsibility of view model is, it can update the model based on the user interaction, and it can also update the view. Yeah. In the MVVM, there is one very important component which is not here, which is a binder. Okay. What does this binder do? So view model exposes the public properties and commands. This binder binds the public properties to the view to render it on the UI, and it binds the commands which is exposed by the view model, which can help to handle the user interaction. I will give you a quick example of the binder. I don't know how many of you have worked with the Microsoft solution stack, but there is a markup language called XAML. So XAML acts as a binder which binds this view model on the view, right? And it frees developers from being obliged to write boilerplate code to make view model and view in sync. Are you guys with me till here? Yeah? Okay. Now let's see the relationship between these components. Here you can see that there is a many-to-one relationship between view and view model. What does this mean? This means that as view model does not know anything about the view, because that is binder who actually binds the view and view model, the same view model can be used by multiple views. So that's why there is a many-to-one relationship. Let's see the relationship between view model and model. It's bidirectional, because view model can update the model based on the user interaction, and view model is dependent on model because it exposes the public properties which helps to display it on the view. So view model is dependent on the model because this is your data. Cool? Now, this was the code which we were discussing, right? Here we have like quite some if conditions over here. What do you think? Can we apply MVVM here? Yes, no, yes, but we have a very important component of MVVM, which is binder, and we don't have it. So I hope you guys know that Android has come up with a binding mechanism recently, right? It's in beta, but they have come up with a binding mechanism where you can bind your data on the view. For this application, we have not used this binding mechanism, so we have to write this boilerplate code to bind the data to the model. But so what if we don't have binder? For example, let's take an example that our activity will act as a binder. Yeah, and let's see that now can we apply a MVVM pattern, and can we extract out a view model so that this all logic which we have here can be shifted to the view model. Yeah, let's apply MVVM and see that how this looks like.
So after applying MVVM, we have created a view model. So we have now this, the view, if you see the before, like everything was being done in the view. Now everything of all the logic has been moved to the view model. Your view is only asking for the label, text color, and the visibility status. It doesn't care about, okay, I have to understand it's new, or I have to understand it's popular. All that responsibility is delegated to the view model. It just, this, the act view just has to consume whatever the view model gives it. So your view has become relatively very thin here. Now, how has this helped us test it, right? Okay, so let me go to the view model. So your view model takes in a product and it takes some resources. It takes in your domain, because your domain is giving you the attributes, is giving the view model the attributes it needs to massage for the UI. So it needs to depend on the domain, in this case the product. The resources is added here because we need to get certain things from the strings.xml and colors.xml, so it's passed here. passed in the constructor. Now, once your view model is created, let's look at the tests we could write because we created this view model. So, these are JUnit tests. First scenario is the label, the popularity view, should be visible as the product is new. The popularity view should be visible if the product is popular. The popularity view should be visible as the product is new and popular. There's a condition, right? Like it's new and popular, still it should come up because we have an if condition there. Your label should be new as the product is new. I'm getting a new product. I'm getting a product which is new, so I should show the new label on the screen, on the view. Your label should be popular as the product is popular. The main thing is the label should be popular even though your product is new and popular. We had a condition, right? Okay, popular label should take precedence over new, right? So that is what we have tested. Similarly, the popularity label color should be red if the product is new. It should be purple if the product is popular. And similarly, it should be popular, should be purple if the product is popular and new. So every single condition around the around the label is tested. There's no problem, or we don't find any insecurity that something we have missed. Let's quickly see if we tend to make some change in the code, does it really fail? Let me quickly run the test. And there, it gave me a failure stating I was expecting a popular label, but I got nothing because I removed the code of actually getting a popular label. And this was so quick. It ran in 0.3 seconds. I got to know what has failed, where did I make a mistake, and I can quickly fix it. So this has given us advantage of immediately, from the unit test, of immediately understanding what is my view model going to the screen and how is it correct, is it not. There's one more thing remaining. We have talked about the data massaging, but there's something around the event interaction which we have not talked about. Let us look at that.
So after applying this MVVM, let's see that what is the code which is still lying there in the product retail activity. This is the rendering part which we have already covered through view model. Let's look at the add to cart. Oops, here also we have some business logic. That okay, if product is already added to the cart, then don't add it and display a dialog message. If the product is not added to the cart, then save it in the database and then display a toast message. What can we do so that we can unit test this part of the activity also? Have you guys heard about MVP? Yesterday we had a session on MVP, right? I hope you guys know what is MVP. Let me just quickly... Okay, let's just quickly understand what is MVP. Okay, so here also we have view model, the responsibility of view and model stays the same. What is presenter here? Right? So the presenter, it's the same thing, it updates the model based on the user interaction and it also updates the view UI. But unlike MVVM, we don't have a binder here, which means all the glue code to bind the data on the view that we have to write over the presenter. Yeah. So MVP was developed mainly to become a view very thin and so that view does not know anything about the backend logic which you can write on your application. Everything should be driven by a presenter. So that's why MVP was developed. Let's look at the relationship between these components. There is a one-to-one relationship between view and presenter, which means that view can hold only one presenter and presenter should only know about one view. Why? Because here there is no binder. It's presenter who actually binds the data on the view. Yeah? The relationship between presenter and model stays the same. It's bidirectional. So let's not talk about it. Now, let's see, can we apply MVP on this logic? Yeah. The obvious thing which could come to your mind, why are we not using MVVM? View model is also responsible to handle the events, right? Why are we creating something like a presenter? But as we discussed that we don't have binder, So that if we want to move this logic to the view model, then we have to expose view to the view model, which is a violation of the pattern. Because here you can see that we are updating the UI. We are displaying a dialogue. We are also displaying a toast message. So if we want to shift this logic to the view model, then view model has to know about the view, which is a violation of the pattern. So then we thought, let's apply a pattern, MVP, and let's see that how my, after applying an MVP, how this code looks like. Wow, it's just one line. Everything has been shifted to the presenter. So this is my view. You can see here that my view has become really thin now. It's very dumb. It doesn't do anything, right? And everything has been shifted to the presenter. Let's see the code of the product detail presenter. All right. In the presenter, we are passing product as a dependency because this is my model. We are passing a product repository. This is a repository through which I am saving a product when user adds the product to the cart. Resources, as explained by Nazneen, if you want to render something and you are depending on the string.xml or colors.xml, then you can pass resources. And we have a product detail view here. Let's look at the contract of this product detail view. Product detail view can render the title, price, popularity, description. So this is all my rendering part. Detail view can also display the toast or it can display the dialogue also. So whatever UI logic, yeah, which we have to do from the presenter, yeah, it is the job of product detail view. And my product detail activity is implementing this product detail view. Is this clear? Are you guys with me? Yeah. Let's look at the test of this product detail presenter. So I can write a test for the rendering part, which view does. Here, we can write a test that, okay, display the toast message on saving the product to the DB. If the product is not inside a DB, then save it to the DB and display a toast message. Also, if the product is already added to the cart, then don't save it, and then display a dialog message that, okay, product is already added to the cart. We can quickly run this test because it is pure JUnit test. There is no UI dependency over here. So this test has run like in 0.37 seconds. Yeah. So like till 6 months ago, we were not using the MVP. We just have MVVM in our project. And we were just writing unit tests for the data massaging part. Right. But then we spent some time to analyze that what can we do with the user interaction part. And then we came up with this. So we have applied two patterns here, MVVM and MVP. Yeah. Let's look at the bigger picture that after applying this two pattern, how my application architecture looks like. So here we have view model. Also we have a model. So the relationship between this, it's same as whatever was there in the MVVM. We have view, presenter, and model. Also, the relationship between this component stays the same as it was in MVP. The only addition here is this. So what does this mean? So actually, view is very dumb. So view delegates everything to the presenter, and it is the presenter's responsibility to create a view model and update the view based on the view model. So here now, a presenter acts like a binder. And presenter is also responsible to handle the user interaction. Is this clear? Yeah? Cool. Any questions so far? No questions? Yeah, go ahead. So what view model, anyways, view model does not know anything about the view. But view knows about the view model, right? View is depending on the view model because based on the data, whatever we have in the view model, we are rendering it on the view. So actually, there is no dependency of the view on the view model. And that was there in MVVM also. In MVVM also, there is no dependency of view on the view model.
We aren't invoking anything of the view. like show to show dialog of the view from view model. It's only pure massaging of the data.
Yeah. Cool. Let's move forward.
Take one more question if you want, and then because these are on the patterns, then we'll move to the next level of test.
Yes, we have. We will share the code with. Is this fine?
Yeah,
we will share the code with. With all of you.
It's on GitHub. We'll push in the, we'll put in the URL so you can take it from there.
Yeah. Let's see that what can we do with the integration testing here.
Right. So kind of using a mix of the MVVM and MVP, we achieved a good number of unit tests at our end. Like we could increase the number of unit tests in our code base. So it helped us also scale our team. So otherwise, if the team was growing and we had no confidence of what we are building, we kept stepping on each other's work, each other's features, and things kept breaking, and we came to know about it very late. So this helped us here. This is evolving this architecture as we go on working on our project too. So this is about unit. When we go to integration. We have tested presenter in isolation. We have tested the view model in isolation, but we haven't checked the binding of these components. So from the view talks to the presenter. Presenter talks to the view model. This kind of binding, the collaboration between these components, are not tested, right? We need some confidence that this is working fine. So let me walk you through the scenarios for the integration test. Sorry about that. So first, let me change the build variant. So we have tested, okay, the UI, the image, the title, the label, the cost is coming up on the UI or not. So we have used Espresso here, which helps us test that, okay, on these particular IDs, is this particular ID actually the value is being seen or not. So we have tested that everything is rendering fine on the UI. Second one is, okay, are you being able to scroll? So we have a scroll view on our details activity, right? Are you being able to scroll and then scroll to the bottom and then click on buy? And is the product actually getting added to the DB? That's the second test. So we have also tested the interaction with our database. Third scenario is the dialogue of, okay, is the dialogue of the item already added in the cart actually coming up on the screen? That's the third test. So let me just run these tests quickly. And we didn't need a functional test to completely build the APK, then run the suit on it, nothing. So we could get a good understanding, okay, all my components I tested in isolation are working fine and I'm getting whatever is needed on the screen. So this is with integration test. Now, there's only one functional test and I'll show you. We ended up with only one functional test because everything else was tested. And what that functional test was? What the function test is. Okay. It's just about, okay, I launched the very first activity. Okay, I'll actually open it up and show you. I launched the very first activity, shopping activity. I scroll to the data. I can click on the electronics. I click on the item in the electronics tab, then it opens the product detail activity. I click on cart, I purchase it, I press back, and I can see that the number of items in the cart has increased. This is what a real user will do, right? This is what your app was intending to help the user do. go see the details, purchase it, and see that the my item is in the cart. So we ended up with, let me look, show you the coverage. We actually ended up with 20 unit tests, six integration, and only one functional. The altogether the other way, then we were some 6 months ago with the inverted test pyramid. So we have, we kind of achieved the pragmatic test pyramid. So this is Jacoco code, the Jacoco results, code coverage results. So this is around for the view model. I have 100% coverage for my product view model. Every single statement is unit tested there. And for the presenter, which allows you to save the product, render the product, I have 100% coverage. So this also gives me confidence everything is tested fine. So at the end of it, applying MVVM, MVP, writing a few integration and a functional test, we kind of came up to the correct test pyramid which is suggested. A 70% at unit, 20% at integration, and 10% at functional. That is how the ideal, how Google suggests. And we achieved it in the last 6 months. So, point we learned, and we want to also share with you all, unit testing or TDD or, you know, the achieving the correct test pyramid is not only for web. It's very much possible for mobile applications. And mobile applications should not be related, okay, it's a different set of tools, it's a different ball game altogether. So it's not achievable. It's very much achievable, and it has helped us also from the scalability of our team, also get a faster feedback, all the advantages I just discussed. So yes, that's it from us. Thank you, and any questions, we're open for questions. I'll answer the first one. Around how do we understand what do we have to, where do we have to test? So anything that deals with massaging of the data, like, okay, again, going back to my example, or take for Book My Show also, if you have to show some Indian currency or some data which is particularly only for the view, it may have to deal later with let us keep aside from where we got the data. We got the data and we need to render it for the view that we put in a view model. So anything that is related to massaging, regardless of where the data is coming from, we put it in view model. Coming to where we understand, okay, we need a presenter here. Whenever we need to talk back to the view, like kind of we need to show a toast, or we need to show, okay, a dialogue is a loader.
Sorry, that was me.
A loader has to be dismissed, or a loader has to be started, or you need to start some other flow. You need to talk to the view. That is when you put it in the presenter. So that is how we decide the interactions. I hope that helps you answer that. Okay.
I would have to interrupt. I'm so sorry. We are running out of time. You can definitely take the Q&A outside.
Maybe we can talk offline.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just a minute.